vote against people being hungry? Wanna vote against crimes of hate? Wanna vote against a big corporation? Wanna vote against Trump Nazis and the KKK? I vote when they tell me. I vote every year. I'm tired of voting for the lesser of two evils, so I wanna make it clear. I wanna vote for one big union. Wanna vote for peace. I wanna vote for jobs and justice. I wanna vote to make healthcare free. I will vote for workers' right to strike, and I will vote for women's right to choose, and I will vote for the right to vote against all the injustice I see. Don't blame me, I voted for Bernie.
Thank you. Leslie Hasberg. We'd like to sing a song now that we're going to teachable, but sing this song for you a bit. I'd like to dedicate this song to Jennifer Harbury, who was the person who was responsible, along with the help of a whistleblower, who got those horrendous audio recordings of children crying in detention centers to our ears. We heard them because of her. And this song was, we were so glad to learn this song from Ellie Grace of Kansas City at this time. So we'll sing it and then we're going to teach it to you. We'll just sing a little part of it and then we're going to teach you that little part.
Look, they've got a T here.
That's an A.
That's an A.
Whoops.
Da, da, da,
da.
That's it.
We say,
one, two.
We say no one, no ban.
We
say no one, no ban on this stolen land. We say no ban, no wall. We will welcome all. We say no one, no ban on this stolen land. We say no ban, no wall. We will welcome all and we will show up and we will rise. Shout it from the mountain. Sing it to the skies, and we will speak up loud and clear. All creation is welcome here.
This is your part again.
We say no one, no ban on this stolen land. We say no ban, no wall. We will welcome all.
And I bring to it the perspective of a third generation activist. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to read to you from the book a little story that my father used to tell. I was raised on my father's stories of organizing the unemployed in Detroit during the Depression. So I knew about economics-based activism, but I hadn't seen it until Occupy. A story my father liked to tell came from 1932, when he was in jail with Walter Eicher, a man he admiringly called an organizer from hell. That was his highest praise. Well, his other highest praise was, she has the gift of celebration, and I feel like that's what Occupella brings. Anyway, luckily he wrote the story down in 1968 for his good friend, labor lawyer, Maurice Sugar, as follows. When Herbert Hoover came to Detroit in, I think, late October 1932, he was met by about 20,000 people at the station at 3rd and 4th. The unemployed, who just loved Herbert, were concentrated right at the corner where he emerged from the station and set up a really effective counter demonstration. The cops tried to break it up, and Walter Eicher, who had climbed the tree at the White House during the veteran siege at Washington, that's the Bonus Army, climbed an iron light pole to better command his audience. A cop started up after Eicher, and I grabbed the cop by the leg so he couldn't climb. The result was that the whole demonstration was turned into a protest, as the attitude of our strategically situated thousand or so quickly communicated itself to the rest of the demonstration. Another result was that Walter Eicher, Willie Getz, another member of the Uncommunist League, and I were thrown into jail, into the bullpen. The bullpen contained about 30 to 40 inmates, more or less, changing as people were called out for questioning, sent to cells, and new people arrived. About the first question asked in a situation like this is, what are you in for? True to form, the prisoner next to Walter said, what are you in for? And Walter replied, non-support. The other guy said, who, your wife? And Walter replied, no, the president. That was a singing period, and Walter and the Leaguers were in good voice. Walter started out singing with some of the old American standards that everybody knew, and gradually nearly everybody joined in. Then he shifted to the work songs, such as Solidarity, Hold the Fort, and others, and ended up with Walter and the Leaguers singing the Internationale and every prisoner marching around between the benches with his fist in the air. About 4 p.m. the next afternoon, we were brought into court on a writ filed by you, that's Maurice Sugar, to whom he's sending this letter. And after some very puzzled and informal questioning of the prosecutor by the judge asked, just what are these men charged with? And the prosecutor answered, hooting the president. The old judge answered, if that is a crime, there are about 15 million of us guilty. We were released forthwith.
There's more to that story in the book, and I have a few copies here.
All right.
And here's the song Nancy wrote. That's kind of our theme song. It's called Occupy Pi. One, two, three.
Thanks to the 16th century.
Yes.
This is you.
This is you.
Yeah, that's you.
Modification here.
So this is a song I wrote called In a World Gone Mad. And the important thing about this song is for every four lines of things that are wrong with the world, there are eight lines of things that are right. Even with all the crap we're dealing with right now, I really do believe that. So, anywhere you go in the world, there are always more decent people anywhere. And it has a sing-along chorus that's very easy. One, two, three, four. In a world gone mad. In a world gone mad. In a world gone mad, I'm glad.
Anybody wants one, get one.
And now
website and get the words, but you can sing with us on September 8th when we'll be performing the Curbside Choir. Check our website, we'll have the details there, and we'll sing this very song that comes to us from Belgium.
What day of the week is that?
It's Saturday.
In San Francisco, we'll be on Montgomery and what was it, Montgomery?
It'll be on the website because we're not sure of the demo group yet.
Yes, yeah.
Acapella.org.
And we will put some cards right back on that back table so that you can take them home and remember to look at that website.
We'll give you a card.
So I have a good sense of what the labor culture is about from the way I grew up. I never met Mike, though, when I lived in Pittsburgh. A friend sent me a copy of his CD to me. Unfortunately, she didn't close the CD, so I couldn't hear the songs. But there were these songs that had these great titles on it, like Hard Times, They're Fighting Times, and the like, and you've got to break the chain, and it whetted my appetite so much, I said, well, I got to get a hold and get this CD. Turned out, I looked inside, and he was from Homestead, Pennsylvania, which is where the steel mills were in Pittsburgh at the time, where I grew up, and I called him up, and I said, hey, how can I get your CD? I got the case, I got the cover, I got I got everything but the CD. So he sent me a package of them, a whole stack of CDs. Mike has over 20 recorded CDs, all with a lot of really kick-ass working-class songs. And when I played the CD, I liked every song on it. And then I put on the next CD, and every CD, I found that I had to learn a song, and I had to get the words, and I had to start playing them myself. Well, better than that, tonight, we have Mike Stott himself to do it, with some friends from the Western Workers and joining us. So let me introduce to you Mike Stout and We're What's Left.
All right.
Thank you. Greetings from Pittsburgh, and I just want to give it up one more time for Acapella. They're a harmony. We're going to have to figure out how to get you guys through Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. When you come through, let me know, and I'll make sure I get a show for you.
Want to throw another
Acapella
in Pittsburgh.
Yeah. That's what it was. I don't know, we got a raging grannies. They might give you some competition. Thank you for having me.
inside the factories, out in the streets, every place where the working heart beats. Together in each, we are the working class. At the machines, out in the fields, down in the mines, a serving the mills. Behind the wheel, we are the working class. Thank you.
was actually from California back in the 1968-1969 period, was a brother named Tim Buckley. And everybody, a lot of the millennials and later generations knew his son, Jeff Buckley, but Jeff Buckley was the son of Tim Buckley, and he got his voice and his talent from Tim Buckley. And so this is a song I wrote, which actually borrowed the music for the melody from Tim Buckley, called The Day Has Come.
Once I was a soldier,
tell you, because a lot of you don't know, maybe Jimmy does a little bit, but most of you don't know my history. I come out of I was one of the original members of the Youth International Party. I ran with Jerry Rubin and Abby Hoffman back in 1968, 1969, and went on to join the Indochina Solidarity Committee and become an active anti-war organizer in New York City. And from there, I went into the Homestead Steel Mill. And if you don't know anything about the Homestead Steel Mill, it's one of the most famous mills in the country when it was still there. And of course, the 1892 strike was there, and it was an epic battle that labor fought. But by the time I arrived in 1977, the mill basically, there was about 8,000 people that worked there. And the union had become lackadaisical, complacent, a tool of management, and pretty much do nothing, absolutely do nothing, and refused to even file grievances, refused to address any of the abuses that were going on. And rank and file, I landed myself when I got to work there, right in the middle of a rank and file insurgency. And I guess you could say back in the late 70s, we were kind of like the millennials of the day. And all the people that were in the rank and file movement, most of us were in our 20s, and we took over the local union, and we took it over, and we ran the local. We kicked the international out, pretty much. We ran the grievance procedure ourselves. I fought my own cases in arbitration all the way up to court, and beat U.S. Steel for about $12 million. They couldn't get rid of us. The International Union and the company tried everything they could to get rid of us, and they couldn't. And the only way they ended up getting rid of us was to pull the, what I call, pull the rug out from underneath our feet and shut the whole plant down. And it was tragic. But in the course of, I wanted to tell you, this movement that I landed myself in was just, it was fucking unbelievable. I mean, the people I met proved that working people, people with a high school education, could write, could sing, could be poets, could be lawyers, could do all the things that professional people do and yet work with their hands and still be steel workers and working people. And we had a newspaper called the 1397 Rank and File Newspaper, and it was the most irreligious, radical newspaper you'll ever see in your life. And the reason it was so radical is, first off, we had four cartoonists who were all National Lampoon, Mad Magazine type cartoonists, and they would draw any picture, and we had a section of the newspaper called Plant Plague and one called Union Plague, and we allowed any member to say whatever they wanted about any member of management or the International Union that was screwing them over. And it was the most democratic expression to this day I've ever seen in this country or read about. And the person that started this newspaper and that got the whole movement going was a 24-year-old woman named Michelle McMills. And to go into the steel mill workers' world at that time, you know, which was predominantly male-driven, male-dominated, and turn that movement into a power and a force that she did was unbelievable. And another guy I met, his name was Frank Domgala. And Frank was somebody that stayed a friend of mine. He was a rank and file leader. He was a poet. He was a writer. He was a thinker. And even when the movement later on split and people started attacking me and red baiting me, Frank stood by my side, and he stood right there with the rank and file people. So when Frank died, I wrote this little song for him. But this song's not just about Frank. It's about all the people that I ran with at that time in the local union. It's called Frankie Domagala. Frankie was the leader of the rank and file down at the Homestead Mill. He had a heart of gold, a spirit of gold. He rolled that stainless steel. A voice for the ones who could not speak. A champ for the underdog. A writer, a thinker, working class thinker, trying to right what's wrong. A union soldier in a 40 war, save a manufacturing base. Back in the years when good jobs were here, heroes had their place. He believed in a democratic union. For the members, he took a stand.
bells of freedom rang. Though ego and power stole the hour, showers of shutdowns rain. Frankie still shined on the front lines, fighting all the way to the end. And when our movement split, some tried to force me to quit. Frankie refused to take sides. At every bend, he stayed my friend. His memory will never die. Just like we was true blood brothers, we had each other's back. 3 decades later, this friendship greater, this bond didn't never crack.
Oh, got the wrong microphone, sorry. I mean the wrong. Sorry about that.
Globalization was just kicking into gear, and the steel industry was leading the charge, and U.S. Steel was disinvesting, and we found out that Mellon Bank had the same people sitting on their board that were sitting on U.S. Steel's board, and so we targeted them, and then we started a movement, a withdrawal movement, to take our money out of Mellon Bank, and we put such a scare in them that they came after us like spending millions and millions of dollars on advertising and sending agents into our movement to split it up and so on and so forth. But we gave them one hell of a fight, so I just want you to know. Another movement I've been involved in, of course, on top of the labor movement, a number of other movements. One is the anti-war movement. And I've been involved in various phases of the anti-war movement for about 50 years of my life. I'm in disguise. I'm actually 69 years old, and I've been fighting against war and imperialism since I was about 19 years old. And one of the biggest movements that I hooked up with was around 1998. There was a movement that actually was organized a demonstration down at the School of the Americas in Fort Benning, Georgia. And it was this SOA watch, it was called. And at its peak in 1998, 1999, we had 20,000 people down there. I was privileged to perform 4 years in a row. And also, I got arrested 2 years in a row. And in 2001, after 9/11 happened in September, they tried to stop the SOA from rallying. And the SOA took them on in the courts. And in the course of, everybody here knows what kind of fear was going on in this country at that time. And 8,000 people showed up in November 2001, and this priest, Father Roy Bourgeois, I mean, what a name, Bourgeois. But Father Roy gave this speech in 2001 at the Gates of Fort Benning that was befitting of Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and Fred Hampton. And the theme of his speech was Not in Our Name. And when I heard that speech and heard about this movement, which actually I think originated here in California, I wrote this song. So this is all of the people who stood up against the war machine and said, Not in Our Name.
not in my Another struggle I've been involved in, dear to my heart, is constant, continuous, and ever-mounting workers' safety and health and death on the jobs. And for about 12 years, actually, the AFL-CIO liked our band for a while. And for 12 years in a row, I was hired every year to write a song by the local AFL-CIO body in Pittsburgh, a worker safety and health song, and perform it. And of course, all this came to an end when I started singing songs about war and the environment. I was cut off and blackballed, basically. During the course of these safety and health, I met some incredible people, some heart-wrenching, incredible stories, and one of them was a member of our local safety and health committee's name is Donna Puleo. And her brother was killed on the job, and he fell 25 feet to his death in a very unsafe condition. He was put in by himself, by management, and when they brought in OSHA, of course management lied, and the company for this brother's death ended up getting fined $6,000 for not posting a sign at the top of this cement mix thing that he dropped into and died. And so I met with Donna, and she asked me to write a song for her brother. And so when you hear this song, this is her story. I sat down with her for dinner one day and said, go ahead, spill your guts out. And especially the third verse is her talking directly about her relationship with her brother. And when you hear me say in the chorus, two 9/11s, what that's referring to is every single year, and this is not counting indirect deaths, you know, through cancer and diseases and so on and so forth. Every single year for the last 20 years, somewhere between 5,000 and 6,000 workers have died on the job in the United States, and nobody gives two flying fucks, to be really honest. And you hear all this stuff about terrorism and 9/11. We got 6,000 workers a year dying on the job, and nobody cares. This song goes out to them.
Tower on a dangerous walk without fear and power.
sister's dream. He bore his burden like a saint without any complaint. Upon her father, upon her husband, upon her brother there lay. My knight shot in armor, my hero Alfred. A giant of all the rovers, a good Union man. What I am, I owe it all to him. I owe him. People that I'm sure most of you have never even heard of that did incredible things. And one of them is a woman named Crystal Eastman. I don't know if people ever heard of Crystal Eastman. Well, Crystal Eastman, those of you who haven't heard of her, let me tell you a little bit about her. She only lived between the age of 19 and 47. This woman did more than any thousand men you'll read about in the history books. She wrote the first workers' compensation law. She co-founded the ACLU.
She wrote the first Equal Rights Amendment. In fact, she wrote the first and only bill that I've ever read that said women who bear children should be paid a living wage as workers. And not only that, but every woman in here, I just want you to know, you can dress the way you dress because of Crystal Eastman. Back in the 1920s, she was the person who was the first woman to go to the beach without long sleeves and long pants, and when her dad physically tried to stop her, she pushed him out of the way and said, "You're not going to stop history." And she was an incredible woman, incredible. And the whole world should know about her. And I'm going to sing this song, and this song goes out to the Me Too movement and to all the women out there struggling for equal rights. Crystal Eastman. Crystal Eastman was a warrior of yore, mover in shape of pad, breaker for sure. Voice for the victims of the captains of wealth, mother of all workplace safety and health. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and rising. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Sister Eastman, your cause is alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. She took a pen to the mills and factories of hell, shined a light where the dead and injured fell. Wastelands of pain and injustice she saw, she wrote the first workers' compensation law. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and rising. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Sister Eastman, your cause is alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Courageous, audacious, always on the front lines, Hellraiser, trailblazer, way ahead of her times. She led the fight to right so many wrongs, charming, disarming, so beautiful and strong. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and rising. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Sister Eastman, your cause is alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Organizer, rebel rouser, brilliant and wise, her words were music, there was fire in her eyes. She sowed the seeds and co-wrote and paved the way for the ACLU and the ERA. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Sister Eastman, your cause is alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. She fought for women's rights and equal pay of the due. Said mothers raising kids are working people too. Her life was a torch that burned for liberty, a symbol of the free woman to be. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and rising. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Sister Eastman, your cause is alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Coat pink was sister to the robber baron's wars, outspoken sister for the peace and freedom force. She was blackballed and dragged through the mud, but in the end they couldn't bury her love. Oh, Crystal Eastman, your spirit's alive and thriving. Crystal Eastman, your name will never die. Crystal Eastman, the time has arrived to tell the world about the love that you gave, the families and the lives that you saved. Hail Crystal Eastman, she worked for peace, and hail Crystal Eastman, she fought the peace, man. Hail Crystal Eastman, hail Crystal Eastman, hail Crystal Eastman. That's for all you women out there. Delaney was an African-American born in West Virginia, in the hills of West Virginia. And when he was 19 years old, his mother was teaching him and his brother to read, and the local constable found out and sent a lynching party for him. And so Martin escaped. Now think about this. This is 1840. He hitchhiked from the middle of West Virginia all the way to Carlisle, PA, which is by Harrisburg in the center of the state, and then hitchhiked to Pittsburgh and made it there alive when he was 19 years old. And when he got to Pittsburgh, he went to where all the African Americans went back in them days, where all the struggles were hatched and where all the battles were planned and waged, and that's the barber shop. The barber shop back in them days was where African Americans hung out, planned, and did everything. And he got the Underground Railroad started in Pittsburgh. He became the first African American to get admitted to Harvard University. In fact, he alarmed the whites so much they got a petition and drove him out when he was 21 years old. He started a newspaper called the Mystery Newspaper, which was the voice for the slaves back in the 1840s. And he also co-wrote and co-authored The North Star with Frederick Douglass. And he also supported and helped John Brown plan his actions. And when Congress passed the Fugitive Slave Act in 1850, there was a rally in Pittsburgh. 10,000 people showed up, including the mayor of Pittsburgh, the city council, and the governor of Pennsylvania. And Martin Delaney got up and gave a speech in front of these 10,000 white people, a speech befitting of Fred Hampton and Malcolm X. And he got up and he said, "Any man or any woman or any human being that tries to cross my door and snatch a slave," he says, "either they will die or I will die." And that includes the President Fillmore of the United States. And this is 1850 he gave this speech. Well, they drove him out of town, Canada. But when the Civil War started, and Lincoln knew he couldn't win the war without the slaves and put out the Declaration of Proclamation, he brought Martin Delaney back. And Martin Delaney was the first and highest ranking black officer in the Union Army. And he led the charge down south because he knew the whole Underground Railroad. He knew all the players. And he basically was very instrumental in winning the Civil War. So this song goes out to all our brothers and sisters in the Black Lives Matter movement and those over generations and generations who've been fighting for civil rights and human rights for African Americans. Martin Delaney. Several lifetimes on the Is there anybody out here that doesn't know we need a new system? This song goes out to you, my brother. Deep shit. I mean, we're at 440 parts per million CO2 in the atmosphere. pushing to 500, and when it gets to 500, you're going to see sea levels rise 6 to 8 feet. You're going to see the coastal shores and the rivers and the lakes overflow and flood, and you're going to see a refugee problem in this country that's going to dwarf what's going on in the Middle East, in my opinion. And at the same time, the scientists that I most pay attention to, I know you've heard 95% are saying that climate change is real, but the ones I probably pay the most attention to are the ones that are full-time in Antarctica and the Arctic, and also especially the East Siberian Arctic Shelf. And right now, you know, it's funny, I was watching a movie about these scientists on PBS, and all of these scientists, like I think 9 out of 10 were women. And they were like women in their 30s and 40s. They weren't, you know, people like our age. They were like young women. And they were not only knowledgeable, but they were putting a warning out, and they were telling us that the permafrost and the ice that's melting in Siberia and Antarctica, especially those two areas, is melting at a rate 3 times of what they predicted just about a year ago. And they said that all these people and these scientists that are saying that this is a problem our children and their children are going to face better wake up, because it's a problem we're going to face. And they're saying that by 2030 to 2040, somewhere in there, we're going to have serious, serious problems if we don't reverse our ways. So this song goes out, called Global Warming, Climate Change is Real, to all those people fighting for this planet. Each more intense, more intense than the other. I guess you all have heard about fracking, right?
Cover the ground.
Well, Western Pennsylvania, where my wife Steph and I are from and live, is ground zero for fracking right now. And actually, there's three major places: Western Pennsylvania, West Texas, and Central Texas, and also Colorado and Wyoming. And the fracking basically is turning our area, which was one of the most beautiful, pristine areas in the United States, at the foothills of the Appalachian Mountains, into a cesspool, into a cancer, what we call Cancer Alley 2, next to the coast of Louisiana. But there's a lot of people out there that have been fighting fracking, and people that have put their lives on the line, and people that are fighting for this country, and fighting for this nation, and fighting for this planet. And one of the brothers that I met, his name was Terry Greenwood. And Terry was a Teamster truck driver for 30 years. And his wife worked at the post office. And for 30 years, they scrimped and saved every penny they could so they could buy a farm in Washington County, south of Pittsburgh. And they moved there after 30 years of working their whole lives and bought a farm. And then these frackers came in, and they started slant drilling in the property next to his, underneath his property. And they told him to sign a lease, and when he told them no, they said, well, too bad, we're gonna do it anyway. And within a matter of months, all of his cows were killed, stillborn, his calves were stillborn, his bull was sterilized, his water was completely poisoned, and within 2 years, Terry died of a strange cancer of brain tumors they never even heard of before. And the problem with the fracking is when Dick Cheney had his special secret meeting in 2005 with all the energy grand poobahs from the oil and gas industry, they refused, and they got what they, I'm sure you all have heard of the Halliburton loophole. Well, the Halliburton loophole says that they don't have to reveal any of the chemicals that they're using in the fracking industry. So even doctors have had to go to the Supreme Court to sue them to try to get to find out what these people who are getting cancer in our areas. And for me, it's become a personal problem, as I have three close friends who have died of cancer. My daughter-in-law, who's only 34 years old, has stage 4 cancer. I have a niece whose husband died of cancer. And cancer is so prevalent in Western Pennsylvania right now that our area now has the worst air and water quality that we did even when the steel mills were there. And we're now 6th lowest in the entire country in our air and water quality. But people stood up and they're fighting them, and they're fighting on your behalf as well as on behalf of their families. So this song goes out to Terry Greenwood and his family and all the people fighting for a clean environment.
To do the suspender.
away. But the drillers were dictators who said you don't have a say.
Getting sick, water tasting funny, hand full of fat. like a tap.
Well, thank you for putting them out tonight and bearing with me here. It's really tough when you got about 175 songs and you're trying to figure out which one to sing. And quite frankly, my wife will tell you, I can sing for like 5 or 6 hours without stopping. So I just love to sing. I love to attack this system. I love to speak truth to justice and justice and truth to power. And I want people to stand up and rise up in this country and fight back. And one thing my daddy taught me, we didn't always agree on anything, but one thing my daddy taught me from the day I was born was when there's hard times in your life, you're fighting times.
Ah!
Andrew Emery. Give it up for my man, Paul. Steve wants one more. I don't care if he's the only one here. I'm going to sing it for him.
Let's hear it for Steve and Kathy. And bring all that to the key, right?
And
all everybody else.
Steve. I can feel your heart. I can see it in your eyes. I can hear it in the pain of a hungry child's cries. And when I look at your soul, I can feel the fires grow. See the flames shooting all across the sky. From Cairo to Sudan, La France to Deutschland, from Buenos Aires to Bombay, Moscow, Beijing to the USA. I can hear you.